comes and goes, but few people really know what it means to really love somebody. Love, though the tears may fade away, I'm so glad your love will stay, 'cause I love you, and you showed me Jesus, what it really means to love. Love, a word that comes and goes, but few people really know what it means to really love someone. Tears may fade away, I'm so glad your love will stay, 'cause I love you, and you've shown me Jesus, what it really means to love. The nights that have cried, you loved me, when I should have died, you loved me. I'll never know why you love me. It's a mystery to me now. I'm glad I see Jesus. When all hope was gone, you loved me. You gave me a song 'cause you loved me. Now I can go on 'cause you loved me. It's a mystery to me now. I'm glad to see Jesus. What it really means, what it really means to
Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. It's so wonderful to see so many of you on this brisk Sunday morning. My name is Dana Corsello, and I'm the Canon Vicar of Washington National Cathedral. And of course, as always, I want to welcome you on behalf of Marianne Buddy, our bishop, and Randy Hollerith, our dean, who is away. He's preaching this weekend in Greenwich, Connecticut, and talking about the cathedral, so that's where he is. And of course, he sends his greetings. Now, before I get into the specifics of sharing the peace and our keeping our hands cleaned and washed, I do have some important announcements. Wonderful spiritual things are going on here, as you all know, and our Easter basket collection that begins this Sunday today back at coffee hour, which of course you're all welcome to join us for coffee hour. We provide Easter baskets to homeless families and children, so I hope you will consider donating to make all of that possible. We had a great take on Lent this past Wednesday. Over 130 people participated. This week, Catherine Sonderegger, just an incredible theologian in her own right from Virginia Seminary. She will be here talking about making sense of God in these troubled times. And then after all the classes and dinner, we're beginning our candlelit compline. It is so beautiful. 8:15, it takes place right up here. The music, the prayers, it's just gorgeous. You're all invited. And then the dean has started something interesting, these sermon talkbacks, where you can go online, you can email or text questions, I think, where he interviews the preacher of the day. So he'll be interviewing me tomorrow about my sermon today. So we'll see how that goes. I'm not quite certain how that's going to go, but we're doing that as well as our Lenten reflections. Now, what's probably on all your minds is how we're keeping everyone safe and healthy during this time of coronavirus and the scare of all of that. And before the peace, well, as we're sharing the peace, we ask that you not use your hands to share the peace. You can use your elbows, you can wave, you can bow. I mean, use your eyes, your words. Oh, as Rose says, yes. What is what is that thing called? Yeah, live long and prosper. See, I can't even do it. Live long and prosper. Just refrain from shaking hands. I think that'll make everyone more comfortable. And then the other thing to know, and it's really important, is that all of our ministers, our lay Eucharistic ministers, the clergy, all of us, we have been washing our hands all morning. Our hands are scoured clean. And we will make sure that the hand sanitizers are here for us, for you, so you can be rest assured we're doing everything in our power to remain germ-free as possible. So now, after all of that, let's just take a deep breath. Just take a deep breath. Let's center ourselves. Let's just do our best to get in the right frame of heart and mind so we can worship God on this second Sunday of Lent. And let's stand and sing The Old Rugged Cross.
So I'll cherish the old rugged cross. Blessed be the God of our salvation.
Who bears our burdens and forgives our sins.
Jesus said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and one another. Gracious God, we confess that we have turned away from you knowingly and unknowingly. We have wandered from your resurrection life and strayed from your love for all people. Turn us back to you, O God. Give us new hearts and right spirits that we may find what is pleasing to you and dwell in your house forever. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God of compassion, lover of our wayward race, you bring to birth a pilgrim people and call us to be a blessing for ourselves and all the world. We pray for grace to take your generous gift and step with courage on this holy path, confident in the radiant life that is your plan for us, made known and given in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Genesis. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred in your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went, as the Lord has told him. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us.
From the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. you will not fall asleep. Behold, he who keeps watch over Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. Preserve you from all evil. It is he who shall keep you safe. The Lord shall watch over your going out and your coming in from this time forth forevermore. My help comes from the Lord, the
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
God's holy name.
I ask your prayers this morning in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
I want to begin this morning by offering a defense of Nicodemus. I am a Nicodemus sympathizer. He has been much maligned over the millennia. John of Patmos in the book of Revelation warned the churches of Asia to be aware of the Nicolaitans, Christians who publicly worshiped pagan gods in order to go unnoticed by Emperor Domitian's boogeymen. And in the 16th century, John Calvin called the silent sympathizers of the Reformation Nicodemites, when they wouldn't dare speak the truth about how the Roman Church needed to change. Fear of reprisal, wait and see to see how things shake out. I get it. We all want someone else to stick their neck out or be burned at the stake. The dictionary defines a Nicodemite as a person suspected of publicly misrepresenting their religious faith to conceal their true beliefs. It's difficult to think that Nicodemus's namesake slur is apt at this juncture in the gospel. Jesus has only turned water into wine and cleansed the temple. But it's also true that he came to Jesus under the dark of night, seeking answers from the teacher he believes to be sent from God. Is he having to skulk around in clandestine encounters because he is a powerful, respected Pharisee? Fearful of being a traitor to his fellow religious authorities, in particular the Sanhedrin Council? Of course. Nicodemus could not arrest Jesus, but once accused and arrested, he held the power of life and death over him. But is he a coward, unwilling to profess the truth as he understands it? I'm not so sure. Perhaps a clue to Nicodemus's motives lies in the two verses immediately preceding our text. When he was in Jerusalem during the Passover festival, many believed in his name because they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, would not entrust himself to them because he knew all people and needed no one to testify about anyone, for he himself knew what was in everyone. I'm going to go out on a limb here and state that Jesus knew what was in Nicodemus's heart. He knew from their first meeting that Nicodemus would never deny or desert him. He knew that Nicodemus was not damning him with faint praise or to hell. Commentators over the years have done a real number on Nicodemus, making him out as the poster child of presumption, painting him as a bumbling, pompous Pharisee, a foolish foil for the wisdom of Jesus. They claim his befuddlement mocks Jesus. I don't buy it. And this is why. By the end of verse 9, where Nicodemus is plaintively asking, "How can these things be?" I'm not thinking to myself, "Geez, guy, how could you not get this?" I'm thinking to myself, "Dude, I'm just as lost as you are." Seriously. So let's replay what happens. Nicodemus comes to Jesus and makes a statement. "We know you are a teacher sent from God. This is true because no one can do what you do apart from God." Jesus replies with a comment that not only has nothing to do with Nicodemus's statement, it doesn't even make logical sense. Nicodemus points this out. Jesus replies with a comment that makes even less sense. and helpfully tells Nicodemus not to be astonished. Astonished, Nicodemus replies, "How can these things be?" This is hardly an interrogation. The Episcopal priest and writer Barbara Brown Taylor has written and lectured extensively on this very back and forth between these two. Rather than be critical of the fact that their conversation took place in the shadows, Taylor asserts that new life starts in the dark, whether it is a seed in the ground, a baby in the womb, or Jesus in the tomb, it starts in the dark. To understand Nicodemus, she posits, we have to know the work of the 15th century polymath, the philosopher and theologian Nicholas of Cusa. In his work on learned ignorance, Cusa identifies three groups of ignorant people in their search for God. Okay, the first group, those who do not know that they do not know. Those who do not know that they do not know. This category of folk speaks of God as easily as they speak of the weather or what they had for lunch. They can tell you exactly what Jesus meant by being born from above and where the wind will blow next. Because they trust in their own wisdom, they are shut off from the wisdom of God. Now the second group, those who know that they do not know, but think that they should know. Those who know that they do not know, but think that they should know. When they see through a glass dimly, they think that they need cataract surgery or new windows. They are enthusiastic converts, easy to discover all aspects of spirituality. They walk labyrinths. They attend every retreat offered. They buy every book that promises to help them break through whatever is keeping them on the wrong side of the glass. In their mid-level ignorance, they do not know where the wind comes from or where it goes, but they think they should. Okay, and then finally, the last group. Those who know that they do not know, but receive this ignorance as God's own gift. Are you with me? Those who know they do not know, but receive this ignorance as God's own gift. Certainty about God is no longer what they're after. It's an intimacy with God that they desire. In their state of illumined ignorance, they do not know where the wind comes from or where it goes, but they can live with that because they trust that God does. They trust that God does. So which category describes you best and why? I'm going to leave that with you. This, my friends, is the category in which Nicodemus finds himself. And I think why Jesus doesn't excoriate him, even though he does challenge him. For Nicodemus, Jesus and his talk of being born from above with water and spirit is elusive. But that, at that moment, when he knows that he cannot know, God reaches him from the divine, moving him from uncertainty to vulnerability, to desiring an intimate relationship with God. It doesn't happen overnight. It is not a lightning bolt to the heart. You see, our Lenten journey offers us freedom rather than conscription. We are to seek and seek until we finally let go of our understanding, comparative, quantified, or logical. And when we empty ourselves of such lofty ideals of knowing and finally admit our ignorance, then we too will find God. Nicodemus appears two more times in John's Gospel. In the seventh chapter, After Jesus has fed the 5,000, walked on water, claimed to be the bread of life, Nicodemus's cover is compromised when he defends Jesus to the Sanhedrin, who are out to arrest and kill him. Our law does not judge people without first giving them a hearing to find out what they are doing, does it? He asserts. And then after Jesus' crucifixion, Nicodemus shows his true self when he comes out in the light of day, bearing a 100-pound burden of myrrh and aloe. He is there to help Joseph of Arimathea take Jesus' body down from the cross and bear him to the tomb and anoint his body and wrap him in linen. It is at this tender, heart-wrenching moment that Nicodemus sees the kingdom of God in all of its glory. When he places Jesus' blood-stained body in the tomb, he is newly born from above. Death and rebirth are intractably linked at this very moment. Together with Joseph, he does what needs to be done. Words and thoughts seem to have become superfluous when facing Jesus' body. Silently, they render a service of love. I don't think Nicodemus is meant to stand for us as a symbol of what not to be. Nicodemus is a symbol of who we are, a group of people longing to make sense of things, to be enlightened, but to understand it in our own time, with our own imaginations, free from guilt or shame. And I believe Jesus loves us for that, just as he loved Nicodemus. But Jesus also knows that sometimes what we really need are not the answers that we crave, but instead to stand in the darkness and open ourselves up to the mystery of God's presence. When Nicodemus let go of what he thought he knew, it's only once he stopped trying to make Jesus make sense that Jesus says to Nicodemus these words, words so beautiful, so important that they have become the cornerstone of our faith. For God so loved the world that he gave us his only Son so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Let us affirm our faith together. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God,
eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
In this season of repentance and healing, we accept God's invitation to be ever mindful of the needs of others, offering our prayers on behalf of God's church and all of God's creation. For the church, that with Christ we may resist evil and be obedient to your word, Lord, in your mercy. For all who will be baptized in the church at Easter, that you may be their strength in all temptation. Lord, in your mercy. For all nations torn by war or internal strife, that they may know your peace and reconciliation. Lord, in your mercy. For the leaders of nations and all in administrative authority, that they may serve with wisdom and compassion. We pray especially for Donald, President of the United States, the Congress, the Supreme Court, and Muriel, Mayor of this city. In the Cathedral's weekly observance of prayers for the states, we hold before you the people and government of Nevada. Lord, in your mercy. For all affected by the coronavirus around the world, for those who are sick and suffering, that they may be healed, and for the families who are grieving the loss of loved ones, may scientists and physicians work to find a cure, and may nations work together as the outbreak spreads. Lord, in your mercy. For all those suffering from hunger in our community and throughout the world, that they may eat and be satisfied. Lord, in your mercy. For all walking in the wilderness of loneliness, despair, or sickness, that they may be fed and strengthened with the bread of life. Lord, in your mercy. We give you thanks for all the faithful who have traveled through the wilderness and now dwell in your paradise. Bring us with them to the eternal feast of joy with you. Lord, in your mercy.
O God, you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son to reconcile earth with heaven. Grant that we, loving you above all things, may love our friends in you and our enemies for your sake. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. My friends, during this flu season and the spread of COVID-19, just a reminder that during the peace, instead of the traditional handshake or hug, use eye contact, an elbow bump, or offering a friendly wave. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Awesome. Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you so easy. So easy. So easy. Easy to love.
Good morning, friends. You did that well. You did that well. Well, again, good morning. I join Dana in welcoming you to this service this morning. If you are a visitor for the first time, a special welcome to you. But I do want to acknowledge there are two groups who are scheduled to be with us. Dallas Baptist University from Texas, are you here? Raise your up. They are. Welcome. Welcome. And also Providence Middle School, California, where are you all? Welcome to you all. We're so pleased that you are with us today. We are now moving from being fed on God's word to literally come together at God's table as we enter the sacrament. All who seek a deeper relationship with God and Christ are welcome to receive communion today. I do want to point out the process in which we are receiving communion. Intinction, which means dipping your bread into the chalice, is not going to be practiced. And so I invite you to receive communion in one of two ways. You may receive the consecrated bread, consume that bread, and then take from the common cup, which will be wiped by one of our lay Eucharistic ministers after each person consumes. Or you may receive in one kind, to receive the consecrated bread and to receive that only. If you prefer not to receive communion today, I would ask that you still come forward. And if you place your hands in this manner, we will know to offer a prayer with you. And one of the clergy will just put a hand on your shoulder and offer that prayer and blessing with you. Also, after communion today, or during that period of time, if you are in need of prayers for yourself or for others, there will be a healing minister who will be available in War Memorial Chapel, and that's right kind of through the other side of the great choir. You can obtain access to that by going through this door, or you may go around there, and our healing minister will be available with you to pray with you and to pray for you. If you are here with us today and you have been blessed in a way that you are able to share some of that blessing with us at the cathedral, we would receive that with joy. The cathedral does not receive any special funding from the government or from the Episcopal Church at large. And everything that we do in this space is supported by the generosity of folks like you in the pew. So if you're able to share with your blessing with us, we are most grateful. But most of all, we're just glad that you are here. Your presence with us has definitely been a blessing. So walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Oh, The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace we are able to triumph over evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. The night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Have mercy on us.
draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Blessed are all those who are called to his supper.
supply, he will supply, he will supply, he will supply.
He will supply, he will supply, he will supply, El Shaddai.
At this time in our service, we send forth the sacrament, which we have shared at this table as the body of Christ, to those in our community who are not able to be with us. In the name of God and this cathedral church, we send you forth, bearing these holy gifts, that those to whom you go may share with us in the communion of Christ's body and blood. We who are many are one body, because we all share one bread, one cup. Praying together, God of our pilgrimage, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Refresh and sustain us as we go forward on our journey. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. At this point, I invite all who may be celebrating birthdays or anniversaries this week to move to the clergy person who is closest to you, whether that's at the rood screen down there, here at the altar, or right behind me, so that we may pray with you. But before we have the individual prayer with you, let us, as a community, pray for those celebrating birthdays and anniversaries. O God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
You.
Today. Surround her with your love. Support her with your grace. And as she journeys through yet another year, give her a grateful heart, knowing that all that she does is to your glory.
Let us bow down before the Lord. Keep this your family, Lord, with your never-failing mercy, that relying solely on the help of your heavenly grace, they may be upheld by your divine protection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
No sin to hide, but you have said.
side to walk upon his guilty side and to behold the Lamb of God, your gift of love they crucified. They laughed and scorned him as he shed the
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My heart beat, and all I wanna do is make you proud of me. He
saves the day.